Once again, good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for joining our session about steel cargoes loading on board ships and transportation by sea. This is our ongoing webinars in the series of webinars, educational webinars. Mostly we delivered on dangerous goods by sea in package form, and one we delivered about IMSBC code, solid bulk cargo. This is about steel cargo. We have Captain Chanda with us, who will be making the presentation. During the presentation and the post presentation, you can type in all your questions, if any, in the chat function. I request all the attendees to keep their microphone on mute, so there will be no echo back. Captain Chanda, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Captain Chanda from Eden Maritime. And today, I and Mr. Shashi Kalada from IMDG Code Compliance Center are going to present this webinar on carriage of steel cargoes by sea. There is a request that we'll be asking you some questions during the course of webinar. Please write your answers into the chat box. And also, please keep your microphones muted. Thanks. We have dedicated today's session to the Varun Dev, the God of Seas. And we hope that everybody out at sea or those working in relation to seas always remain hale and hearty and safe. The objective of today's webinar is to spread awareness about the safe loading of steel cargoes on bulk carriers. What are different types of steel cargoes which are loaded on the ships? What are different knowledge sources for loading these steel cargoes? Cargo securing manual, what is CBS, which is California block stowage? What damages to the steel cargo that happen? And what kind of cargo claims are faced in this industry? Now, before we proceed, I have a very simple question that loading of steel cargoes on bulk carrier, it shall be in compliance to number one, IMSBC code, number two, IMDG code, number three, grain code, or number four, it will be in compliance to cargo securing manual, CSS code, and the charter party. CSS code is code of safe practice for cargo storage and securing. You can write your answer 1, 2, 3, 4 into the chat box, please. Answer is number four. Whenever we are going to load the steel cargo, we have to refer to our cargo securing manual. We have to refer to the code of safe practice for cargo storage and securing, that is CSS code. And we also have to refer to the charter party. Now we'll discuss about them now one by one. Now, what are different kinds of steel cargoes which are transported by sea? We transport steel coils, plates, WRC, that is wire rod coils, bundles of steel sheets, steel billets, H beams, steel angles, pipes, slabs, and rebars, reinforcing bars. Very often, all these cargoes get transported by sea. There are many more cargoes, but most often, these are the cargoes which are being carried by sea transport. Now, have a look at this picture. This is the cargo hold of a vessel at the discharge port. Well, I can say that we all can say that this is a indeed very lucky vessel which arrived at the discharge port with a cargo condition like this. Because if the lashings break down because of heavy weather damage out at sea, and these coils are like footballs in a cargo hold, and if the weather is bad, they can just pierce the ship side, leading to water ingress, and we can lose the full ship if this is the situation of the cargo in the holds. Now, this is another situation where the cargo is the situation of the cargo hold. When the hold was opened, the cargo is found like this. And then, as we can say, it is really lucky vessels to reach their discharge ports in this situation. Vishwa Mohini was a vessel which was lost in the Bay of Biscay and resulting in the loss of 31 lives. This vessel was carrying steel cargo and coming from Europe to India. And it was carrying steel cargoes, and the loss of this vessel was attributed to the lashings breakdown and ultimately piercing of the ship side and the water ingress and the sinking of the vessel. Of course, this incident actually happened in 1990s, but it doesn't mean that it cannot happen today. At the least, we'll have a situation like this when we have very hefty cargo claims. For example, in this particular case, we have a cargo claim of 88,432 euros. So we want to avoid these things into the industry, and that is the reason we are here today. The fact is that at the discharge port, if the cargo condition is different from the BL, it will result in the cargo claim. Whatever has been signed by the master in the bill of lading at the load port, if the cargo is anything different from that cargo at the discharge port, it will result in a cargo claim. And we'll be surprised that in the USA, most of the cargo claims are against the steel cargo, and their maximum of the claims are in the US itself than anywhere else in the world. Not only USA, if we take the case of Europe also, or say for that reason, any other country, if they are not finding the steel cargo same as it was loaded, it is going to result in the claim. But the way the cargo entered in the hold, the same way it has to come out in the cargo from the cargo hold. If anything different, it is a claim. Now let's see how the loading of the, if we see the capacity plan of a vessel, for example, this vessel, this number one cargo hold can load 8,030.2 metric tons. Number two cargo hold can load 9,977.5 metric tons, and so on. How this, suppose this is a solid bulk cargo we are loading, then how does this cargo looks like when it is being loaded into the cargo hold? It looks like this. Now with this cargo in the cargo hold, the forces acting on the tank top are homogeneous. So usually this is how the bulk carriers, they were designed for, and they were going to get loaded for this kind of cargo. But what if we are loading a cargo of steel? Now when we are loading a cargo of steel, this is the situation. For example, we have steel coils. Here we can see the point loads are 150% of the weight of the steel coil, 200% of the weight of the steel coil, or again 150% of the weight of the steel coils. Now let's see what is the what it actually is causing. Now when we are planning a steel coil stowage in a cargo hold, we have to follow three general rules. First is that we follow vessel's cargo securing manual. Whatever information is there, it is given in the cargo securing manual, and we follow that. Now next thumb rule is there from the Japan T&I Club that weight on the tank top in way of the bottom tiers should not be exceeding 3 times the maximum permissible load of the tank top plating. For example, if the tank top plating load density is 20 metric tons, then the weight in the way of the bottom tier cannot be more than 20 times 20, that is 60 tons. Also, as a thumb rule, weight in each tier should be less than the 90% of the total weight of that cargo, as if it has been loaded like a solid bulk cargo. For example, if we have a width of hold 19 meter, length of the coils is 2 meter, tank top load density is 20 tons per metric square, then if we load this cargo and we take the 90% of this cargo, it turns out to be 684 tons. So if we calculate row by row, then if we are calculating at 90% of the solid bulk cargo, then we are keeping ourselves in the safe limit. So this is just a general thumb rule which have been given. This is to be kept in mind when we are loading a steel cargo. Now, what is the information we have from the stability booklet of a vessel? We have the tank top measurements as given at the bottom. For example, number one cargo hold, we have 27.8 into 3.2 and 19.1. The length is 27.8. 3.2 and 19.1 for number one hold is because number one hold is going to taper to the forward. So forward side, the tank top width is 3.2 and the aft side is 19.1. Hold number two, three, and four, they are rectangular in shape. And hold number five, again, the forward is 19.1, the width of the hold. And the aft side, as the hold is tapering to the aft side, the width is 8 meters. And the tank top strength is 20 metric tons per square meter here. And we have a crane capacity here, which is 30 tons. So this is a very important information that we need to check from our stability book before we load this cargoes. Now let us come to the steel coils loading manual or the cargo securing manual, whatever is given for the vessel, and what information is given here and how we are going to use this information. Now suppose before I proceed, what is the meaning of a key coil or a locking coil? All of us should know. A key coil is a coil, as we can see here in this picture, which is loaded between the coils which have got space between them. And now key coil is very important, or key coil or locking coil also it is called. It is very important to keep this stowed tight and allow and it will not allow the coils below it to move. Now we have a question here that if a key coil or a locking coil which is shown in the picture, it is considered as a part of the first or the bottom tier, it is a part of the second tier, or we can say it's a part of both first and the second tier, or none of the above. Please feel free to write your answers into the chat box. This coil is a part of which tier actually? It's a bottom tier, first tier, or none of them, or what is the case? Please write your answers into the chat box. Well, yes, we are overwhelmingly right. The key coil is a part of the bottom or the first tier on which for which it was meant for. The space between two of these coils, one more coil should have come, but the position has now changed, which is this. So the key coil is a part of the first tier, or we can say the bottom tier, whatever is the case. Now, what information do we have from the cargo securing manual? In this particular vessel, for example, for the cargo hold one, when we are loading the steel coils of 22 metric ton, and we have two tiers of cargo being loaded, steel coils being loaded, if we are using three rows of dunnage, the length of the coil required at least is 2.2 meter. Then we can load. Means 22 metric ton coil, two tier high, three rows of dunnage, length of the coil should be at least 2.2 meters. But if we are having four rows of dunnage and the length of the coil becomes lesser, it is also allowed to be loaded. So that in that case also, if 1.9 meter is the length of the coil, that also is acceptable. So we can see that as the number of rows of the dunnage are increasing from three, we made it to four, even if the length of the coil or the width of the coil become lesser, that is acceptable. So the number of rows of the dunnage plays an extremely important role when we are loading a steel cargo, because it helps in the distribution of that weight on the tank top of the vessel. Now let's see, there is another very important information which is given in the steel cargo loading manual or the cargo securing manual. Now this first table is without key coil, but we'll take the second table, which is key with the key coil, which is most likely to be the case when we load a steel cargo. If we have a coil of weight 30 tons and we are loading with three wooden dunnage, and the length of the steel coil is 2 meters, it is okay to load. Means 30 ton coil with three wooden dunnage, 2 meter is the length of the coil, it is okay to load. But when that same weight is it the when the length or the width of the coil become 1.5 meter, it is not okay to load. It means when we are reducing the length of the coil, the same weight of 30 tons is taking that area of within the 1.5 meter length of the coil. So it is more condensed weight, so it is not okay to load. So as we see again, the wooden dunnage, how many layers were laid, played a very important role. And what is the length of the coil, that also plays a extremely important role when we are planning the stowage of the steel cargo. Now, another important point I want to bring to your attention here is that a coil of 30 tons, what about the coil? We have given example for 30 ton coils. What about 25, 20, 15 tons coil? Now, 30 ton coils, one tier, it also means we can load 15 ton coils of 15 tons, two tier high, or we can load of coils of 10 tons, three tier high. So that is acceptable. But of course, if a coil of 25 tons is there, we cannot load it too high. A coil of 20 tons is there, we cannot load it too high. Coil of 15 tons is allowed to be loaded too high. A coil of 10 tons is allowed to be loaded three tier high. Now we have after this brief information about how to load a vessel, how to plan the storage of the steel cargo on the ship, a very small question. Let's see how much we have understood. Now this is a vessel, this is our ship, and the charterers have given us instruction that we have a coils of 27 metric tons and we have to load it three high. This is the instructions from the charterers. As we can see that coils, the point weight acted on the tank top is 81 metric tons, and also on the sides 47.25 metric tons weight is acting on the tank top. Now let's see how much we have understood. This coil arrangement is allowed to be loaded Yes, or it is not allowed to be loaded. Please write your answers. This is a small indication whether we have understood the basics of the steel coil loading or we have not understood. Yes, we are overwhelmingly right. Now we gave a Japan P&I club, we have instructions that the point load at the bottom tier cannot be more than 3 times the tank top strength. So here the tank top strength is 25 tons meter square, and the 3 times means 75 tons. So, but the weights are acting up to 81 tons at the bottom, at the tank top. So this loading is not to be allowed into the cargo hold. It will damage the floors in the double bottom, and we can end up in the troubles and depression and tension of all sorts. So we don't want this kind of loading to take place. So 27 tons coils, 3 tier high, cannot be allowed to be loaded for a tank top strength of 25 tons. Let's move forward. Now, what are hot rolled and what are cold rolled steel coils? On the left hand side on the screen, we see the hot rolled steel coils, and on the right hand side screen, we see the cold rolled steel coils. I'm sure these are very common names that we have heard, all of us who have sailed on the bulk carriers, whether we are deck officers or engineering officers, we are marine or technical superintendents, all of us must have heard this name, CRC, HRC, cold rolled coils or hot rolled coil. Let's see about the general knowledge. Now, which is the correct statement with respect to the CRC, hot rolled coils, and the cold rolled coils? Number one, hot rolled coils is a finished product. Number two, cold rolled coils is a finished product. Number three, both are semi-finished, or either of them might be finished or might be semi-finished. Which is the right answer? Which is a finished product out of these, hot rolled or the cold rolled coils? Please write your answers into the chat box. Well, the answer is number two, the cold roll coils. It is a finished product. It directly goes into the factory. For example, whether it is the car industry where they are using the steel, or any other industry, this is a CRC or the cold roll coils is a finished product which directly goes to the market, and they mold it, and we have our car or whatsoever you can think of made of steel is ready before us. So cold roll coils is a finished product, as we can see in the bottom picture here on the left hand side, and also it is extremely much more expensive than the hot rolled coils. Let's move forward. Now, how are the steel coils loaded on the ships? As we can see, this is a very common picture on the jetty. Coil is coming to the, in the trucks to the vessel. This is a CRC coil coming to the vessel. And how do we plan the loading of the steel coils on the ship? This is how we plan. Loading of the steel coils, we always start loading from the port end and the starboard end. We come towards the center, both from the port and starboard. It's not like that we start from port and go to the starboard side completely, or we start loading from the center and go to the port and starboard. No, we load always from the ends and then we come to the center. One very important point, as we have discussed earlier and we have seen in the cargo securing manual also, we have 3 layers of dunnage being laid below this cargo of steel coil. The idea is, of course, to the weight of the coil should that get distributed over the area over which this dunnages have been kept. Now we should see that when we are loading this dunnage, that they touch the extremities of the coils. If we touch them each other, then that much is the only area that was being used by the coil weight to get distributed. So these dunnages should touch the extremities of the coil. So that is, we have to keep in mind when the stevedores are loading this coil. Now let's move forward. Now this is the second coil which is getting loaded. The loading, as I said, started from the port end or the starboard end, and then we are loading the next coil next to the previously loaded coil. Okay, now let's move. Now let us load our vessel further. Now, one extremely important point I want to bring to the attention is that ISPM 15, which is International Standard for Phytosanitary Measures, the dunnage has to be stamped. Why the dunnage has to be stamped? It is a guarantee that there is no insects and there is no pests which are there into the, in this dunnage. If no country wants to have a tonnage which is any, nobody wants to import any pests or insects into their country, and nobody will accept this if it is not stamped, the certificate of the tonnage has not been given, nobody is going to accept this tonnage at the discharge port. Also, not only this, the cargo also might get rejected. The receiving port, receiving country can refuse to accept the cargo if because the tonnage is not stamped with IPPC stamp, or it is called as per ISPM 15, IPPC is International Plant Protection Convention. Now, this is the stamp, how it looks like. IPPC is written on the left-hand side. D stands for the country code. Then we have the code of the producer. And then we have the type of treatment which has been given to this wood so that there is no insects or there is no pest into this. As you can see here, we have a ST stands for the heat treatment, MB stands for the methyl bromide treatment, and DS stands for the dielectric heating. So any one of them might be, any one type of treatment might have been given to this tonnage. As you can see on the, these are the stamps which they are, how they actually look on the tonnage. On the left hand side, you can see this CA stands for Canada. This KR stands for Korea, and IPPC is there and the square is there. These are confirming marks. On the right hand side, we have some non-confirming marks. Some additional information is given and here the square is not there. So that is the reason why these are non-confirming. The left-hand side is confirming marks. Also, as we can see, ST means heat treatment was given. MB means here methyl bromide treatment was given to this wood. So we have to see that the tonnage is properly stamped. Otherwise, nobody, they might even refuse to accept the cargo itself. Now, let us start loading our cargo further. Now, as we are loading our cargo from port and starboard, and we come to the center, and we have loaded this key coil or the locking coil. Now, with what information we have learned so far, is this the right way of loading this coil? Yes or no? Just have it, just you can think of yourself, this is the right, looks, loading looks like the right, the way it has been stored. And yes or no, please write into the chat box. Then we will discuss why it is yes or why it is no. But of course, we will be loading, somewhere we'll come to a situation while where we have space is not enough and we have to fit a coil on top, which is called as a key coil. So whether it is allowed or it is not allowed to be loaded the cargo like this into a cargo hold. Yes, we are overwhelmingly right. We cannot load a key coil like the way it is loaded here. And why, we will see now. Now, when we started loading from port and starboard and we come to a situation in between that there was not enough space to load a coil in between, we loaded our key coil. Now the key coil should sink in between the space of these two coils such that not more than 1/3 of its dia is sinking between the two coils and 2/3 of this dia should be outside the those two coils which are below it. If it sinks more than 1/3 of the dia of its into this space which is between these two coils, what will happen is that the forces will act on this coil during the rolling in the out at sea and they will going to make this coil overlized. And this cargo is will be likely to get rejected, or it, the overlized coil will always going to result in a cargo claim. So we need to be extremely careful with that. That we are not going to load a coil when we are more than 1/3 of its dia is sinking into the space between them. Now loading of the locking coils, as we see, this is the correct way as it has been loaded on the ship. The there's the coil is there where the this is the right, it's not sinking more than 1/3 of its dia between the coils below it. And as we see also to bring to your attention that the coils which are there below it, they are never supposed to be lashed with each other. They will be only with the lashed with the coil, with the key coil. As you can see, the lashings are only from key coil to coil below it, key coil to coil below it. We never lash these two coils which are below the key coil to one another because we don't want the forces to act in this direction when they are pulling each other. We just want the these two coils to pull the key coil which is above them. Also, I want to bring to your attention, as you see this cursor, these are the tonnages, wedges which has been put. The coils which are on the port side, the wedges have been put on this side so that they keep being, they always be pushed on the port side. And coils which are on the starboard side, the, you see the wedges here, they will be in the direction that they always be pushed to the starboard side. So this is how the this wedges have been has to be inserted, keeping in mind that on the one side the cargo will be pushed to the port side, on the other side the cargo will be pushed to the starboard starboard side. Now this is actual loading. As we can see, now there's a this is the two coils which have got space in between them, and we have loaded a key coil. Now this is another in the same tier. We have one more space here. The two coils have got space between them, and a key coil has been loaded. So we might have be having a two in case we have a two here. So again, with this we come to our next question. While loading steel coils in a tier in a cargo hold, which of the following statement is correct? Number one, there might not be need to have any locking coil. Usually there is one locking coil in each tier, or there might be two locking coils in a tier, or all of them above are correct. Which is the right answer? Please write your answers into the chat box. Well, we are right. All of us are right. Answer is number 4. All of the above are correct. See, when we are loading our cargo hold, there might be a situation that the space is just enough so that all the coils of a particular tier got fixed, and there was absolutely no need to fix any other coil as a locking coil because space was exactly enough for the number of coils that we had loaded. And the second case is that there might be one locking coil in this tier, and or there might be two locking coils in a tier also, because sometimes when we are loading one locking coil, the situation becomes like that the coils when we are loading the one locking coil, it is sinking more than 1/3 of the dia into the space. So that again is not acceptable. Then we have to make provision for two locking coils. Though all of the above are correct. Now, are the coils always loaded with their send axis in the fore and aft direction? No, it is not like that. As we can see in the picture here, we have a cargo of coils which have been loaded their fore and aft axis pointing in the sky. So this is called as a top hat coils loading. As we can see in the port hand side here in the picture, this is how the cargo has been brought to the ship, and the coils are being loaded with their fore and aft axis pointing in the sky. This is called as top hat coils loading. This is we can see in the picture here. This is how the coils have been loaded. Now let's go forward. When we start lashing our coils, we have with us steel straps, we have lashing bands, and we have the lashing tools. As we can see here, how we are going to use them. Let's see. Now this is the lashing equipment. It can be manual or it can be pneumatic. Whichever is the case depends upon the ports. So this is how they are presently taking the lashing of the steel coils. Now lashing of the steel coils. Always remember, when you start lashing, suppose we have loaded here one tier stacking, or it may be 1.5 tier, or we have a 2-tier stacking lashing plan for this. Whenever we load at the ends during the rolling, the maximum forces are going to act. So always at the ends, lashing has to be double steel bands, and also the locking coil, the lashing has to be double. And I said the locking coils, the coil below the locking coils, they will be never be lashed with each other. So again, with the 1.5 tier stacking, coils which are to the extreme port and starboard, double lashing; locking coil, double lashing; all other lashing, single. 2-tier stacking and port and starboard, double lashing; key coil, double lashing. And I also want to bring to your attention here is that if you see these coils, these are the coils which are not being lashed with each other. And see these coils also. This coil also has been not been lashed with each other. This is pretty normal way of lashing, because when the coil has got coils all around it, it is not going to move. So don't be afraid that why these coils have not been lashed with each other. It's okay, because a coil which has got coils all around it, it seldom it is going to move. That's why we don't lash the coils to each other. Only the coils which are on top, they have been lashed with these coils. We can have a 2.5 tier stacking plan for the lashing plan. Again, at the ends, double lashing. The locking coil will be double lashed, and again there will be coils which have got coils all around it. There is no need to lash between themselves. Again, 3-tier stacking plan, and again we have coils which have not been lashed here, but these are the coils, as I said, they are not going to move because they are totally packed by the coils around them. Now we can have a 3.5 tier stacking. Again, ends double lashed, some coils, no lashing. 4-tier stacking plan. End coils, port and starboard extreme ends, double lashed. We have the coils which have not been lashed. So this is how the lashing takes place. One thing I want to bring to attention here is that this 3.5 tier stacking, 4 tier stacking. It seldom happens with the case of the hot rolled coil. These are always the plan for a CRC coil. CRC coils are usually lighter, so we store them 3 high, 4 high also. But the HRC hot rolled coils are usually very heavy, and we never go 3 high, 4 high like this in case of the hot rolled coils. And as I said, the locking coil is always double latched. Now this is example I have given. As you can see, these coils is just next to the hopper, if you see. And if you see the bands, they are all double steel bands, as we have shown in the lashing plan also. These are double steel bands, the lashing has been taken. Now when we start loading a coil, we do the silver nitrate test. Silver nitrate is a colorless liquid. If it falls on a surface which was being affected by the seawater, seawater means sodium chloride. So when it get up, when it reacts with sodium chloride, it will becomes white in color. But for example, during the loading of this silver nitrate has been poured over the coil, and it is passing freely without any forming any color. It means the coil is there is no there is no chlorides. The coil has not been affected by the seawater. Now, whenever the cargo reaches at the discharge port, again a surveyor is going to come, and it is going to do the silver nitrate test. And in the silver nitrate test, exactly he will do like this. If it becomes white, it means the cargo was affected by the seawater, and there will be a claim. Let's see how the surveyor is going to act. Now see this. This is the surveyor who has come to vessel at the discharge port, and he has poured the silver nitrate on the coils, and they have become white. So it means it proves that the at some point of time, wherever the cargo got exposed to the seawater, that's why the silver nitrate became white. Also, as you can see this streak, the silver nitrate test is positive, and it means that there is a seawater damage to the these are the HRC coils, and it will result in a claim. And again, as you see the coil cargo at the HRC coils, the solid looks rusted, and on the right hand side picture we can see that this is already silver nitrate is all making white color. It means positive for the positive test, so resulting in going to result in a claim. Now what about this cargo? This is a HRC coil, and the straps outer windings have become loose. Now suppose this cargo gets loaded first, and if we try to make these windings tight, it is extremely impossible, because even if these steel bands, they cannot remain in position. This is a deformity of the coil. Now, so even when this cargo has got discharged at the discharge port, it might have to travel another 1,000 kilometers to its destination, which is not possible to carry a cargo like this, because it will be dangerous to carry open coil like this. So again, there will be a claim, because they have to first take this coil to the factory, who will tighten these windings, then the cargo will be lashed, then only the cargo can be fit for transporting. So this is a case again for the claim. Again, as I said, this is a chafing damage to the winding edges, but this is also in HRC. Now for the CRC cold roll coils, as you can see this picture, the bottom tier of the coil has got compression damage. Literally, it has got completely crushed. This usually happens when we don't know how much cargo is to be loaded. For example, here the 3 tier high this coils have been loaded. Now sometimes the cargo itself doesn't have the inherent capacity or the property that it can withstand that much of the weight, or sometimes what happens is that weight of the coils which are loaded above these coils, the weight is more than the bottom coils. In that case again, the bottom cargo will get crushed. So on the ship, please make sure that never a heavier cargo is loaded over a lighter cargo. Secondly, even though our cargo securing manual is allowing this cargo to be stored 3 high, but even then we have to check with the shipper, can it withstand that much height, that much stacking? This cargo has property that to stack that high or not? So we need, here we are dependent on not just on our knowledge, we are dependent on the knowledge of that shipper, who will decide and he will declare that that particular coil with this much length, this much weight, this much CRC or this much specifications, this much thickness of its plating is okay to load 2 high, 3 high or 4 high. Only once we have that declaration, the stack height letter from the shipper, that And based on that, we can load it 3 high, 4 high, or whatsoever. Otherwise, we can have a damage like this. Now you can see this cold rolled coils, which have got completely damaged, and it's going to be a claim. And now when the claim comes, we are all parties there and try to prove that it's not my mistake. We want to avoid that situation itself. Sometimes we have on CR coils, the packing is distorted, like we see in this particular case. Or now please, all of us, now this is what is wrong with this picture. Suppose we are surveyors now, and we have this, there is a vessel which is discharges cargo, and the cargo is in the lying in the storage yard now, and we go to the cargo and find this picture. So just think from a surveyor's point of view, this is how the cargo looks. What is wrong with this picture? Well, there is a hint. Look at this. Well, yes, these are the water level marks which are there on the cargo. It means at some point of time, this cargo was standing in the water. That's why this water level marks have appeared. Where this cargo was standing in the water, it means it might be because of before loading the cargo in the load or during the in the truck there was some cargo, or in the cargo vessels hold, this cargo was standing in the water somewhere, we don't know, but it was sitting in the water at some point of time. So now if I am a surveyor, if I see like this, I will always be apprehensive regarding the condition of this coil. So I will investigate it further, that whether this cargo has been damaged by the water also. As I see, even the moisture is the damage of a cold roll coil. It's a so delicate cargo. So forget about if we are literally water. We have got the evidence here that what this coil was standing in the water. It can result in a lot of claim at the discharge port. Now this is the cargo which has been literally standing into the CRC coils, which are literally standing into the water. It means the cargo storage, wherever this cargo is stored, the facilities are inadequate. Now again, as you see here, this coil also has got water level marks. So now as a surveyor, now let's see, we have to open this covering and see what is there, how this cargo looks inside, because I'm sure this water has gone inside this cargo and what it has created. Now inside, the cargo is covered with a brown paper. We have sometimes additional tarpaulin, and then we have a brown paper. The cargo had pierced into the brown paper, as we can see these water marks, and the cargo was affected by the water. So this is a 100% claim on the, it can very well result in a claim on the cargo. So we have to avoid the situation like this. Also, we can see here, this is again a water mark, and when we opened the cargo, we found it to be exact the water level marking on the brown paper. It means that the cargo is affected by the water. Now, why does a cargo which was wet or that got loaded into the ship, and sometimes it is not even being reported into the mate sheet? Well, whenever we are loading a cargo of steel in the rainy season, for example, nowadays in India, we have a rainy season, whether it is Bombay or Vishakhapatnam or Paradeep, wherever we are loading, a lot of rains are taking place. So we don't know, sometimes in the stockpile, sometimes in the trucks, or even when we are loading cargo on the ship, anytime it can rain. Now we need to be extremely careful loading the cold roll coils, that do not try to open and close holds 4 times in 1 hour. When it starts raining, it will take at least 15 minutes to close from cargo hold 1 to cargo hold number 5. So even if the shippers are pressurizing, you open the holds, and we keep just following them, we will end up spoiling the cargo. It is very difficult. Suppose there are stewards inside the cargo hold. There is a crane hook which is cut down in the hold, and suddenly it starts raining. You tell those people, come out, come out, come out, and they are just slowly, slowly moving their way out. You can't close the cargo hold. You might, otherwise it will be a case of manslaughter if somebody dies in the cargo hold. So we have to let these people come out. And by the time we have closed the hold to prevent the damage, there is cargo hold is already full with the water. So again, we have to avoid this situation. Then we have to keep fighting with the guys, that your mistake, our mistake, that mistake, his mistake. So don't want the situation to that happen. So do not come under the pressure of the shippers or whomsoever tells us load, load, load. we will end up spoiling the cargo, because that guy just want to dump the cargo on the ship and he will run away. He will be left answering here and there. Many times we have even the local surveyors, they are under the lot of influence of the local shippers. They will tell that they will influence him by money or any other mean, that the whatever is the cargo we have, it has to be loaded on the ship. Sometimes this loading takes place day and night, all five holds loading in one port 24 hours. How much will be a ship staff be able to see? Boat and holder gives you even duty officer and AB on the deck. And how much they will run around TC1 or what type of cargo is there? The P&I surveyor that has been appointed is another man of the shipper himself. So again, it's very difficult to control. But our point of view, what we can do is, if you see a very slight chances of rain, don't load the cargo, close the holds and escalate the matter. No, nobody is going to penalize you if you take 10 days to load or 15 days to load full cargo of steel coils. But definitely there are going to be penalty if the cargo gets wet. It is not in anybody's interest. It's not like the person, we have to understand, other person is in pressure. He wants to get the ship loaded as fast as possible and get the ship out. But we cannot allow cargo to get damaged. Then the whole purpose is defeated if the cargo gets spoiled. Sometimes the voyage itself is so long. We have got 35 days cargo at sea. A very slight rust which was there at the load port. And it is like a full grown rust after 35 days of sea voyage at the discharge port. So it is a voyage is so long. And now even the slight, very slight rust at the load port has to be properly mentioned into the mate's receipt. We cannot write atmospheric rust. Just say rusted. Because that atmospheric rust can, by the time at 35 days later, when you take out the cargo hold coils you take out or any other cargo you take out, it has already formed pitting on the cargo. And when the pitting of the cargo has taken place, the cargo has become off-spec. It is off-spec now and the cargo can get rejected. So condition of the cargo has to be exactly reflected into the BL or mate's receipt or the BL. Now what is wrong with this picture? Now so much we have discussed about cargo. Steel cargo. Now find out what is wrong with this picture. If anybody can make out, please write your answers into the chat box. This is also very, very important factor. Now, what is this cargo? This is a cargo of WRC, wire rod coils. I'll tell you what is wrong with this picture. You see here this coil, the full cargo is touching the corrugated bulkhead forward or aft, whatever it is. And the whenever we cannot load a steel cargo with a steel to steel contact, because whenever the sweating will take place, the cargo which is touching this bulkhead, it will get damaged, it will get spoiled. And the full stack has got tilted. Why this has got tilted? Because they never stopped loading. They kept on loading high, high, high. Everybody wants to load more cargo and keep on loading as high as possible. But the whole stack has got tilted. So now again, as I said, as a ship staff, several times it is not possible for us how much stack height, what should be the maximum stack height. We are dependent upon the shippers or the local surveyors at the load port. So it is just nothing but dumping of the cargo load as much high as possible. Because, you know, every single ton means dollars. You have, whenever we load this cargo, we have more and more shippers, charterers, always want to load more cargo because this is a voluminous cargo. So they want to load more and more. And it has been loaded beyond a certain stack height and the cargo has got collapsed. Now, for the wire rod coils, I want to bring to the attention that, you know, how the lashing. Lashing is how it is taking place. The top side is being lashed. The sides are being lashed and the central wire rod coils, which are got cargo all around it, is never lashed. This is same as if with the steel coils, a coil which is coil all around it is not lashed with each other. So the same way the central wire rod coils are not lashed to each other. So we have to keep bear this in mind whenever we see the lashing of this wire rod coils. Now we might have a situation where the brake bulk is loaded like we see in this picture. Now we don't have any lashing plan for this. I also don't know how, I cannot comment now how to take lashing of this cargo. That depends, again, we are dependent upon the experience of the people who are loading cargo like this. So we can expect anything nowadays. So we need to be, we can expect anything into this situation. We must see the charter party also whenever we are loading this cargo. For example, for the steel cargoes, we have a point mentioned that steel cargo shall always be loaded within the vessel's permissible load in accordance with the vessel's loading booklet. The California block storage system is not allowed to be load, not to be allowed. if there is any preloading service to be done, the cost will be divided 50-50 between owners and the charterers, and the charterers will be liable for all removal of dunnage, separation, and making good any paint coating damages at the discharge port. So this is usually points are usually there in the charter party. So whenever we have a voyage instructions to load the steel, please always refer to the charter party. Now, why does it say here? What is this California block stowage loading system not allowed? What is this California block stowage and why it is not allowed on the ship? Let's see. Now, what is California block stowage? This is California block stowage where the cargo is loaded on the hatch center. How this cargo is loaded in the hatch center? See this. Now, usually this California block stowage is done for the slabs. Why this cargo? And this is the requirement of the California steel industry. So whenever a cargo is being loaded for the US, especially the slabs, I am saying, they want the cargo to be loaded like this in this shape so that during the loading also there is no use of any forklifts, and during the discharging also there will not be any use of any forklift. Because of this, the port outturn becomes very fast. On a traditional bulk carrier, if you are loading cargo like this, immediately they can or any ship, the cargo is only within the hatch square, it is very easy to load and discharge the cargo. Out the port, the outturn is going to be very fast. But why it is not allowed on several ships that we saw the charter party not allowing this card of loading, as we can see here. See, in this case, the cargo is not touching the ship side. It is likely that it can, the cargo might get shifted to either side, port or starboard, because port and starboard is free, especially in normal bulk carrier with hoppers and topside tanks. So that's why in the charter parties, many of these charter parties, this kind of loading is not allowed. So that's why, as I said, usually it's not like that California block stowage is unsuccessful system. It is successful. Many ships they carry and they make cross-Pacific, cross-Atlantic voyages, take the cargo to the US and they are discharging this cargo, especially in case of the steel slabs, I said. Not like rebars here. This is just one off case. But steel slabs, they have, because it is being said that even up to 52 degrees rolling the steel slabs, because of the friction between their surfaces, they will not move. But many charter parties, as I said, they don't allow it. This method of California block stowage is best suited actually for the vessels which are where the holds are the box shape, like, you know, double hulled bulk carriers where the hold is like this. Here you can see this method of loading, absolutely no problem. All cargo is only in the center. And loading discharging is very easy. The crane can straight away reach the cargo and take it out. So again, the loading and discharging is very fast. So for the box ship vessels, though which are very less in number, there the California block stowage is very frequently used. But for a normal bulk carrier with a hopper tank, topside tanks, even in the charter parties, they will say we don't allow, because there always a fear that the cargo will get shifted, no matter what is the system. Another very, very important thing I want to bring to the attention of everyone is that sometimes the cargo is brought hot to the vessel. Now, this particular vessel, this was loading a cargo directly from a steel factory which was close by. The cargo was literally shining when it was coming to the vessel, and the cargo temperature was high. Though this shows 53.2, but actually the cargo was more than 60 degrees centigrade high. Now, this cargo which is shining exactly, we found it is hot also, maybe 60 degrees, 70 degrees, sometimes even 90 degrees is the cargo temperature. And we get loaded this cargo, you know, in the cargo hold. The steel cargo will cool off also very fast. And when they get loaded into the hold, the air above it becomes very humid. And as soon as the air is humid, the cargo becomes cold. The inside the cargo hold, its air is very hot and humid. As soon as the night happens, now there is a lot of sweating takes place. The car hold sweating takes place because outside is cooler, inside the cargo hold is hot. So the lot of sweating takes place, and that sweat can fall down on the cargo. As you can see in these arrows, this cargo has got this rust marks. This dripping has happened from the hatch end beams on the cargo, and in the load port itself the cargo has got rusted. In this particular case, the shipper got vessel arrested at the load port itself. So we have to be extremely careful, especially when we should check the temperature of the cargo. As I said, sometimes cargo is coming just from the factories, and it is very hot. Any hot cargo loading is not to be allowed. Now, finally, we come to the mate receipt. So, mate receipt should actually give indication what kind of cargo, what is the situation of the cargo, and exact number of coils. For example, 15 CR coils, inner packing cover dented, 13 CR coils, outer inner edge protector ring dented bent. So, exact number of coils need to be mentioned. So, exact condition of the cargo need to be reflected in the exact number of coils, that what was the situation of the cargo. And I said, the way the coil has gone in at the discharge port, when it comes out, it should exactly match with the condition as mentioned in the mate receipt. Now, this mate receipt marks has to be transferred to the bill of lading. But you see here the bill of lading itself is a fraud, because whatever the marks we had put there, those remarks have not been put here. Now, why it happens is that many of the cargo shippers insist, they say to the charterer, see, our cargo is all good. We don't want any remarks in the bill of lading. So if you want to load, then we give you our cargo. If you don't want, we'll find somebody else. So to get the business, charterers agree. Okay, we will not put any remarks on the bill of lading. Clean BL will be issued. So no matter what the vessels has written points in the mate receipt, what the vessels P&I club has written, the BL have been issued clean. And whatever happens at the discharge port is only to fight. So this is a fraud itself which happens. No remarks on the BL, on the steel cargo. Now, this is another situation where you see the plates have been loaded that high. As you see, everybody wants to load more and more. Keep loading as much as possible. Now, you see there is an empty space in the hold also. That space was not utilized. And this full stack has become tilted. Again, this is a miracle that the cargo has reached safely and the vessel is safe at the discharge port. As I said, out at sea, all these plates, whether it is the steel coils or steel plates, these are toys in the holds. They will rip apart the ship side like anything in case of bad weather, in the lashings game. So again, out of, as I said, we should not allow the cargo to be loaded to that height. But as I said, it needs experience also. And nobody wants the damage to happen, but these happen. This is a fact. Or sometimes the damage can happen by, this coil has fallen down from the crane itself, from the top. After loading these plates, the plates fell down all the way from the top. So be very careful. Nobody should be there below the this. Nobody should be working below this cargo operation, especially below the cranes in that area. Keep it out of bounds for everyone. Otherwise, you can see the steel plate itself has got completely bent. You can imagine if somebody is there down, what kind of injury it will cause. So this is also has happened. Now, yes, gear handling marks are also there. So again, this will be noted at the discharge port. And steel plates are sometimes wavy. Why they have been wavy? Because they were loaded also wavy. That is the reason they became wavy, as we can see in this picture, or we see in this picture. So never allowed this loading, because after 30 days voyage, the plate is permanently bent like this. And then they'll say it's a claim. You brought a wavy plates for us. And sometimes these are steel sheet bundles. Again, they were loaded wavy. And the discharge port, they are wavy, they said, because of you. Now, let us come to the how much is the claim. As you can see here, we had level marks on the coils. We had salt water damage to the hot rolled coils. We had the mechanical damage to the plates. Total bill, including GST, is 88,432 euros. Thank you, sir. So this is how the situation exists. After doing all hue and cry, after a voyage of 1 month, taking cargo to Europe, America, and this is the bill they gave us, that you pay now, you brought this cargo, you additionally pay us this much amount. So unfortunately, things like that, they happen with the steel cargoes. We need to be careful. So finally, a steel cargo successful voyage, it requires help and cooperation from everyone, P&I surveyors, superintendents, port captains, charterers, shippers, stewards, ship staff, everybody. And that never allow weather to take over you. You take over the loading operations. Never allow somebody to press you that you open the holds now. Decision of opening the holds should always be with the ship staff. And you should keep in mind how much time you will start to take the cargo from number one to number five cargo hold, how much time you will take to close the holds. Keep in mind that there will be all five holds are people working down. And the rain will come so fast in the Indian East Coast, West Coast, in the monsoon season. If you are taking 15 minutes to close the hold, it will be full of water. And I said, we have to be extremely careful. Learn as much as possible regarding that cargo. Try to get whatever information you get from whatever source. Whatever small, whatever is the cargo condition, it should be exactly written down into the matrix. Atmospheric rust means nothing. You must write rusty. So E&I club should be good. They should be able to help you. As I said, just a very minute layer of rust, or what you call as atmospheric rust, at the 35 days layer, it will become fully rusted. It will become pitted. The cargo will become off spec, and everything, all hard work has gone down the drain. So also the follow, as I said, to save the ship structure, follow the ship's cargo securing manual and avoid any overstressing of the structures. And finally, when we are taking the cargo, we have heard about the also about this sweating, hold sweating, cargo sweating, hold sweating. So we have to check the dew point temperatures. Nowadays, the many companies, they hire specific experts who keep telling the vessel, okay, what is your dew point temperature? They check the records and then they will tell, okay, keep ventilation or don't ventilate. This is to avoid the damage during the course of the voyage because of the, to avoid any cargo sweat or the sea sweat. So that's all from our side. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, you can always ask us. And another thing, very important, that entering into the cargo holds should be avoided, because so much accidents have happened that we never know the air inside the cargo hold. You have to be fully, you cannot be sure about that air. So entry into the cargo holds can only be taken place after proper and closed space entry permits have been filled up and approved. And so any cargo in the hold, whether it is steel cargo or any other cargo, then we need to see that nobody enters the hold. Otherwise, a lot of accidents have happened. Any questions we can take up? Otherwise, Mr. Shashi Kalada, over to you now.
Thanks, Captain. Thank you very much for this excellent presentation. And thanks all attendees for joining us. I can see a lot of seafarers have joined, or ex-seafarers. It is good to know that, you know, shoreside and seaside people are coming on a common platform for common understanding for safe carriage of goods by sea. Any questions, if you have, you can type it into the chat box. Captain Chandra will answer. And I just mentioned in the chat, for carriage of steel coils in containers, we need to refer to CTU code published by United Nations Economic Commission for Europe, as well as the individual container operators guidelines for lashing and securing steel coils in containerized transport.